Let's take a look at some information and charts on Compound for Brave New Coin. So Compound is a lending and borrowing protocol, along with Maker and Aave, making up the big three. In general, with lending protocols, you need to see what's being lent, for how much, what do those markets look like, who's borrowing, what do those liquidations look like, the usual suspects for the analysis. Comp is also a governance token, and a few weeks ago, they announced a treasury component, which is when the price kind of reversed in a bullish fashion rather quickly ahead of all of the other DeFi markets. So Compound the protocol is DeFi through and through. I mean, you can get a loan with several types of collateral without credit checks anywhere in the world, right? That is the DeFi dream. The question is whether or not KYC AML regulations will come for things like Comp eventually. My guess is yes. I don't know in what form or fashion, but I think it's coming for all of DeFi. We just saw today that the EU is trying to ban anonymous crypto wallets. I mean, good luck with that. Just unenforceable completely. But that's the type of thing, right? When regulators see this, I think they get extremely worried. If we look at the total supply on the lending side of things, they quote themselves at 13.8 with a 6.6 borrow. That's in billions. Most of it is USDC and DAI. And again, like I said last video, like Maker, like Aave, if most of this stuff is just stablecoins that are centralized, even DAI, which is over 50% USDC by collateral, at what point, it's like the ship of Theseus, we just keep changing planks on that ship and replacing it with stablecoin. At what point does it not become decentralized, right? At what point can the USDC overlords at Circle have some say in where the USDC sits? You know, I don't know at this point what they could do, but I'm just saying, like, that's clearly a weakness here, right? There's a weakness if USDC says something about regulation because they have to from regulators, right? If I'm a regulator and I'm looking at the breakdown here, that's just the low-hanging fruit, right? It's USDC because that has a company behind it that's in the US that can be regulated and follows regulations and abides by regulations, but they're calling for additional stablecoin regulations. So if you're looking for a black or gray swan that could shake up the lending and borrowing markets on DeFi, that is definitely something that could come. I mean, Tether, you know, has long been in the sights of regulators for a variety of reasons, but additional regulations are coming, so be prepared for that. Anyway, they quote themselves at this supply and borrow rate. You know, we look at TVLs on three different websites, you get three different answers. I don't really know what to say, what the TVL is. I think TVL is a silly metric anyway, but it's significant, right? There's a significant billion plus, at least 5 billion in TVL. I don't know if the TVL being calculated on DeFi Llama, for instance, is based on like lending minus borrowing. I have no idea what's going on here because they only quoted at 7.2. So I don't know. Anyway, these are the metrics. These are the numbers. These are the markets. They're adding more markets slowly, I believe. Looks like they're finally deprecating some, which is good. The worst thing you can do is just like Polo, right? Just list a bunch of junk, have it sit there forever at low volume until finally somebody comes around and says, hey, we should probably delist some of these. These have been long since delisted, but it amazes me that stuff like BAT has found its way, has weaseled its way into being used as collateral on all these borrowing and lending platforms. Just mind-boggling to me, but hey, I don't make the rules. The borrow APYs are on the side here, and you can see some of these are quite significant, right? 10% on Uni. The stablecoin rates are usually lower, so it's definitely something to consider if you're actually using the platform. This is the treasury component that they announced. And if you're an ICO, if you're a sushi DEX, right, of the world, and you have your treasury in crypto, stuff like this is extremely attractive if you're smart about it, because the worst thing you want to do in a bear market is hold everything to zero and then say, oh, should we have done something about that? And then short it at the bottom, right? Substratum did this expertly with their ICO treasury. But we saw this, you know, people are high on the bull market. They become maximalists of ETH or their own token. They're developing. The market does market things regardless of development, and price is falling, right? Price continues to fall. Everybody sees the treasury dwindling. People get angry. Some people say, why don't we do something sooner? Some people say diversify. Some people say, I see, you know, like the Zeke treasury, for example. I see the Zeke people, the community specifically say, why are we holding any fiat? We should be holding Zcash. And it's just like, well, guys, look at the chart, right? Zcash has been down only since the beginning. Maybe it's smart to hold your treasury in something that's stable. So anyway, all coins, including the young and the old, could benefit from stuff like this, where you can convert sell your sushi treasury, right? Just sell it all. If you want bear market protection, sell it all, convert it to USDC, deposit it on here or sushi or wherever, right? But this is a great way for extremely large, even, you know, anybody can take part in this, but especially beneficial to large treasury crypto only type of stuff for sure. So I think it was appropriately bullish for Compound, the protocol. I don't know about the token. And everybody loves to buy token news for things that don't affect the token necessarily, but it's going to make Comp, the protocol, more popular. So if you're bullish on that, then I guess you can say, all right, let me buy the token. Here are the lending rates on the left here. This is when you actually go into the app and you can just, you know, deposit. It's extremely simple to do. Lending rates are quite low across the board. I can't sort here, but looks like DAI is around 2.5. This is just baseline without the comp rewards, I believe. I believe they aren't included here. And then these are the borrow rates, which are higher by a significant margin, probably based on supply and demand. They also have a governance component. And most of these votes are just A16Z, Polychain, you know, the usual venture capitalists voting. Looks like A16 hasn't voted on many, neither has Polychain. But for the most part, unless it's a big, big issue, right? Unless it's a presidential election, most people don't vote, right? They don't vote in the midterms. Certainly less people, at least in the United States, vote in the midterms. I forget who it was, but the UK or somebody was seemingly having an election like every other month. And it always amazed me that people actually turned out to vote for that stuff so frequently. Obviously, it's easier to vote for stuff that's on chain than in real life. But that's just an example. Most people, in general, in my opinion, could care less, right? Most people don't hold comp for the governance side of things. But always interesting to look at if there's ever a disagreement on treasury components or listings, things like that. That's always the most interesting, when the votes aren't just like 90% plus passage rate, when there's actually a debate. That's when it's worth checking out the governance side of things, in my opinion. Like I already said, on DeFi Llama, we get a $7.2 billion. If you look at DeBank or DeFi Pulse, you're going to get a different number. But this has recovered slightly since the May 18th nuke. It's funny how basically open interest was maxed out on TVL May 10th. And then less than a week later, everything just gets nuked. It's kind of how things work. The more TVL, the more open interest, the bigger the opportunity for a massive drop fairly quickly. And currently kind of stabilizing around that $7 billion number. And if we look amongst all of the Ethereum dApps, Compound sits here at number 4 or higher. You know, I don't know if this TVL makes sense, right? But in any case, it's at the top around company of Aave and Maker. Instadap is a terrible name for anything, just like Bullish Global for an exchange. Just pick a name that doesn't exist for anything else. This is not, that's not acceptable, sorry. Because when people see that, they're not going to know what it is. So they're currently number 1 on the Ethereum chain. If we look at TVL over time, again, along with borrowing volume, which is definitely important to look at, borrowing volume has actually bounced pretty considerably, and liquidation volume has quieted down since May 18th. And borrowing volume compared to the big three for Compound is currently at the top, not by a wide margin, but in the blue here, the blue slice, continues to get more and more just action. And if they add initiatives like the treasury stuff, they're going to see that. You're going to see incentives go to Compound versus everywhere else. And this is great for everybody, because you're going to see these platforms and protocols continue to release incentives to get people to jump onto their platform. So good for them. You know, this lending and borrowing stuff is great for everybody, honestly. And like I already said, liquidation volumes for Comp quieted down over the past month, and certainly across the board. I mean, that May 18th spike, I think, was the biggest on record as far as on-chain liquidations. It's probably going to take a significant drop from here or in the future to even get close to that. Looking at some on-chain stats, Transaction counts have been trending down since late 2020, with some spikes here and there. Big spike here on that Treasury news that hit a few weeks ago. But since then, transactions have quieted down considerably. Average transaction values kind of following price for the most part, as is normally the case. You see big, big spikes towards the top. This is another way of looking at days destroyed. In general, people are pretty good, especially whales. They're intuitive at selling the top or creating the top. And you typically see a lot of on-chain activity towards tops. It's a way to look at it as a leading indicator, but also obviously in hindsight, you could say, all right, well, a bunch of comp got moved here, right? I don't know what the actual top was, but probably fairly close to that number. NVT is rising slightly, but in general, just ranging. I think NVT for governance tokens is just not a useful metric. It doesn't make any sense. Although in general, you want NVT to be declining, not rising. Active addresses continue to decline along with transaction counts. So again, not bullish on paper per se for anything, but again, this isn't your run-of-the-mill currency. This is more of a buy and hold speculative thing. I couldn't look you in the face and tell you what any of these governance tokens honestly are good for. There are rewards attached for with this one, like Curve and like all the others. So I don't even know if there's a good signal here that you could ever take from governance tokens in general. One signal that I do like that I'm growing on and warming on is MVRV relative to price. MVRV is a measure of market cap versus on-chain activity. And for the most part, on the left axis here, you can see between one and two, you can use it as a as an oscillator. Anything below one is oversold. Anything above two is overbought. So if on-chain activity, we'll say it like this, if market cap is 2x on-chain activity, then that has generally been towards the top of things. And if market cap is below on-chain activity, that says it's undervalued. So you can see how far down we spiked on-chain activity relative to market cap here, down to 0.7. So anything below one starts to become a buy, and then anything further down is just a bigger buy, right? It's more and more oversold. And historically, on this spike down, it was never this low with on-chain activity. Now, this doesn't necessarily jive with me saying on-chain metrics are pointless for governance tokens, but if the signal is here, right, then it's worth paying attention to. It's probably too early to know. I mean, this stuff is barely a year old at this point, but definitely worth looking at on all these coins, regardless of age. Now, what is the oversold, overbought metric for MVRV relative to price? Looking at PE ratios or market cap versus annualized revenue, 30-day rolling and sort of projected out to a year. These will adjust and change over time depending on revenue and market cap, obviously. And it's interesting that over the past month, these PE ratios, for the most part, have increased pretty significantly, other than synthetics, which was high to begin with, remains high relative to the pack, right? We can only do this with a few tokens that have either protocol revenue or supply side revenue based on volume. Nevertheless, Compound is down here. SNX is up here. Aave, Maker, right? Now, Maker is pure protocol revenue in that it's not based on supply per se, whereas Uni, for example, is pure supply based on the volumes of the exchanges. And Sushi continues to be at the bottom of this list, even though the price chart looks terrible, right? So this is just a part of the analysis anybody should do for decision making. This isn't like end all be all. You should buy these three and not these three based on this metric, right? Helping you make your decisions on things. And it looks like Comp got a little overheated, especially relative to Aave and Curve on that run up recently. So again, I don't know if there's a signal here, but I know people look at this, so it's worth looking at and paying attention to. Let's move on to technicals, 5200 EMAs, VPVR, monthly pivots, last month and this month, and RSI. So last month I was talking about potential moves lower for comp to the yearly open, and it looks like a W double bottomed, and then it had that news that was extremely well timed. It's funny how those things work sometimes. Again, if you're on a deserted island and you had no clue that that news was happening, you could have front ran it by saying, all right, this is a W double bottom, right? I know what's going on here. But anyway, you had that massive spike up, leading everything in DeFi, really. I don't think anything bounced as hard as Comp did. Comp basically returned to its previous range, which is super impressive. Since then, it's sold off considerably along with everything else. But this is putting in a potential inverted head and shoulders. This isn't formed yet. It's not even close to breaking because it hasn't even completed yet, right? The completion is when it returns to 500, 490, whatever that is. So if this bounces here, returns to 490, then the entry triggers from 490 to 740. Currently, it's sitting on this pivot, but thus far, the inverted head and shoulder setup looks legitimate. Also, the resistance lines up with that VBVR profile, and you definitely don't want to go lower here because there's not much support until 200 again. The 5200 has crossed bearish and been bearish since before that news hit, and it's kind of just flat now. So if this can recover, you'll get a golden cross with an inverted head and shoulders completion, which collectively together, along with the VPVR resistance break, should propel this higher, right? So definitely a close setup to watch over the next few weeks. Certainly within the month, this should be either broken or completed, right? Something else to mention on all these charts, there was a pretty big bullish divergence, and you're not going to know this is a bullish divergence unless you are aware that even on equal RSIs with a lower low, that is considered a mild bullish divergence, right? So you've got your bull div plus W plus news. That was enough, right? Now you're attempting to complete a pretty big reversal. And these targets are kind of conservative. So if this does complete, I could see it going higher than 720, certainly. But it's got to get to 500 again. It's got to break that level. This has had a history of inverted head and shoulders at this level around the 500 mark previously. So it certainly looks better than probably everything else in DeFi right now. Daily cloud, now it's below the cloud, has a bullish decay cross. Essentially, the price just moved too fast for these settings in this time frame, and you can recognize that just by seeing how volatile price is, right? This was below the 10kin, then it was above the 10kin treasuries for the Kijun. If you know what you're looking at, that this is a type of TK C clamp, TK disequilibrium, then you can say, all right, it's probably time to stop shorting along with this W of a bottom. That maybe we're going to mean revert here, which is one reason just pay attention to a different time frame. You know, look at the 12 hour instead or the 4 hour when things are moving super fast. I mean, this thing within a month went from 850 to 200, right? That is a crazy, crazy dive down. So when things speed up, you kind of have to move down the time frames a little bit. When things slow down, you move up the time frames a little bit. So currently, you know, just a jumbly mess. But again, if this inverted head and shoulders completes, you're going to see a 12 hour breakout, and you're going to see a daily breakout if it is successful at bullish reversal. But that's, again, like weeks away, but worth paying attention to. Comp BTC, I said this last video, just gumbly jarbly mess. there's nothing. It's just, you know, maybe there's some chart patterns in here, but I don't think there's a giant signal other than here's your range, 007 to 015. You know, it's going to be there forever until it breaks up or down. Monthly pivots aren't useful. 5200 isn't really too useful. RSI may be useful, but not at current price levels. Just sitting in the middle of a range, nothing to really comment on there. Comp ETH has never been bullish since inception. So if this does flip bullish, that's something worth paying attention to. It has a history of bullish divergences at lows. So that's also something to pay attention to. If this goes lower, wait for the bull div. If this goes higher, wait for the 5200 cross, wait for a breach of 0.25 on VPVR, basically where all the volume is sitting. You know, previously it had this sort of macro inverted head and shoulders, failed at the 200, broke down, right? Failed again at the 200. So this is the third failure of the 200 breach. And from here on out, it probably goes sideways until there's one impetus to go up or down. So again, there's not really a trade setup here. It's more of a wait and see and watch what's going on. So love lending and borrowing. Love this as part of the DeFi pillar. Love it as part of the ecosystem. Watch for regulations to smack this price chart down in the near term. You know, this setup looks great, but we're in a bear market broadly. So expect bear news to have a bigger impact than a potential chart pattern. And on the other hand, if you're on a deserted island, and you're paying attention to just the chart and you're waiting for this Inverted Head and Shoulders to play out. That is a slam dunk entry for me, 10 times out of 10 if this breaks above 500. Lastly, I'll just mention the EPTC fund and the DeFi portfolio I trade for Techme Capital on Enzyme.finance, non-custodial portfolio management tool where you can send ETH or USDC. There's no vesting, there's no lockup. There are fees, but we only make money. We only take fees if we're making money and there's a high watermark. So this one, obviously, we aren't taking fees on because we're not above a dollar or the last watermark. The last watermark on this one was maybe 150. So both of these are down significantly since the highs, obviously. The DeFi one was started April 9th. People were asking, I think, in the last video in the comments, why this monthly return is so poor. Well, we kind of started it super late, and DeFi has just been really dumping ever since. Nevertheless, this is allocated into around 15 DeFi-related coins, including Comp. I'm getting rewards on Comp through yield plays that I'm able to do through Enzyme, and I can shuffle these around into anything I want. That's part of the beauty of this dApp, is I can move stuff around frictionlessly, and I can sort by APIs, and that influences my decision, or APYs rather. So lots of fun stuff to be done there. And BTC neat side of things, currently kind of 90-10, a little bit of BTC. I had to let some go yesterday when we broke 30K, because that's just not, you can't be holding when we're breaking lows like that out of a range. And in the trades tab, you can see everything I'm doing, when I'm doing it, for how much, where I'm doing it, all done through DEXs. Really great system. So anyway, that's all I have for this one. Like, dislike, comment, share, subscribe. Happy trading.